Today's video begins with a beer, as it often does. This is Farmery Brewing's Pioneer Harvest Stout from Neepawa, Manitoba. A small brewery that prides themselves on having all the ingredients come from the same farm where the brewing is done. Very cool idea. So interesting things happen when you've got a YouTube channel and have had one for a little while. Companies start sending you stuff and saying, hey, can you review this for us? So, I mean, lots and lots of companies do that. But most of them, I say, nah, I'm not really interested in that. Occasionally, a company reaches out and says, hey, we got something you might actually be interested in. And in this case, they were right. This is a meter. A multimeter. Specifically, a digital clamp meter. This is from a company that I hadn't really heard of before I started seeing their stuff show up in YouTube reviews. They are called Kaiweets, I think it's pronounced. And it's a nice little case here. Yeah, Kaiweets. Don't know much about them. As I said, there's a few other guys on YouTube that have done reviews of some of their meters. But this is one that I hadn't seen many people review, so I figured, hey, if they're going to send me one, might as well get one that that doesn't have 100 other people doing reviews on it, right? Just to take a look and see. So, in the package, as you can see, there is the meter itself, a couple of little AAA batteries, an assortment of leads and probes and things. Ah, that is a thermocouple. Okay, so it can obviously do temperature readings. At least I hope it can. And then there's this set of leads. There. Sort of flexible. I mean, they're a little bit more flexible than these ones. And they feel a little bit thicker, which you'd hope because that's the cheapest meter in the world over there. Comes with little dust caps on them. Nice, I guess. I'm not sure why. They've got these little condoms on here so that you can just probe onto a board without accidentally getting your fingers on them if you're careless enough not to have your fingers behind there. Okay, I guess that's reasonable enough. Most new meters are coming like that anyway. And a little manual. I'm not going to read through everything. Safety instruction. It's all in English. Okay. What's the quality of the English? It's not bad. I've seen a lot worse. Okay, but whatever. Actually, let's find the specs in here, I guess, first. See what they claim this thing can do. 600 volt range, DC voltage up to 700, AC volts up to 700, AC amps up to 600, using the clamp. 600 ohm range up to 60 meg range, I guess. And it's auto ranging. Capacitance, okay, from 10 nano up to 100 micro. Frequency from 10 hertz up to 10 meg. Wow. And duty cycle, 1% to 99. So it can read PWM. Interesting. Temperature reading from minus 40 up, minus 40 up to 1000 C. Wow. I'm not going to be able to test a lot of these, at least not to the extremes. And I think, because it's a clamp meter, okay, I should probably go into this. So a clamp meter is designed for measuring current in circuit without having to interrupt the circuit. Most meters, to measure current, you have to actually put the meter in series with the circuit to measure it. That's the beauty of these. You just go around an active conductor. So what do we got here? 600 amp AC and DC, 60 amp volts AC and DC. Looks like it's got a low pass filter, frequency and percentage, diode check capacitance, your beeper, and ohms, temperature, and low impedance. Okay. Got a hold slash non-contact voltage. Okay, so it's got a built-in chicken stick. I guess that's probably in the front of there too. Interesting. That's a hard plastic, so it's not I mean, it looks sort of industrial from a distance, but I'm thinking this is more of a heavy-duty hobby meter rather than a light-duty industrial one. But it might work for that. Let's pull the back off and see what's in there. That could be interesting. This is obviously the battery compartment. Screw is not captive. That's a bit of a negative. Yeah, two AA's in there. Or triple A's, I'm sorry. That screw is... Okay, so the screw for the battery cover, which is the one you'll actually be using frequently, is into a little brass insert. But these two screws, which they assume nobody's going to touch very often, are just self-tappers into the plastic. Okay, there's the back off. Well, that's interesting. The battery contacts are just onto little springs there. So what do we got? Brain box, crystal, fiddle 8-pin chips. That zero insertion guy goes up to the clamps. So there will be just an inductor in there, or it'll be a big inductor that, it sort of wraps around there. What else have we got? Little buzzer. You know what I'm not seeing on here is a fuse. Okay, a little calibration pot up there or something. Okay, I mean, it's a very nice layout. It's not a blob like the cheapest meters in the world. It's got a few discrete components going on. Nicely laid out. We got a, what is that? Okay, that's a non-contact voltage wire. All right, so that just probably goes up to some kind of an inductive pickup up in the top there too. The other side is going to be, it's going to be zebra stripes onto there and a little rotary switch on the board for that, and not much else on the other side. Okay, that's all reasonable enough, except for the lack of fuse. But yeah, I guess we'll toss this guy back together and see what kind of tests I can devise for it. So as I usually do, I'm going to do the basic tests against the most accurate meter that I can borrow from work. In this case, a Fluke 289. Let's start with DC volts, because that's easy, and I've got my little power supply here. So we'll flip this down to the voltage range, and it comes up in DC volts automatically. Okay. Okay, I realize that's not ideal. Go with me on this. So with this thing turned off, this guy's showing 69 millivolts, so is this. Cool. We'll turn it on in 5, it's set for 5 volts, 5.021, 5.017. Close enough. Let's pull this down. Okay, this says half a volt. That says 509 millivolts, 508, 509 millivolts. That's pretty much bang on at the low range. All right. Let's start going higher then. 12 volts, a common voltage for an awful lot of uses. Automotive dudes, you might be interested in this. So 12.01, 11.998. That's well within any kind of percentage spec. Let's crank this guy up. Okay, so this is 18.98, which it's a buck, and that's basically the incoming voltage. So 19 even there, 18.985. That's pretty damn close. I see no problem with that at all. How about some resistances? Okay, what does this look like? So it goes straight into resistance mode, okay. I'm just using these high power resistors because they're easy to handle and easy to see on screen. This one is a 100 ohm resistor. The reference Fluke calls it 101.7. The Kaiweets calls it 101.5. Sounds like close enough to me. What is that one? 2.5K. Fluke says 2.462. 2.463 on the Kaiweets. That's damn close. What else we got in this little box of tricks here? Let's go big. How about 25K? 24.86 on the Fluke. 24.87? 88? Again, I see no problem with those numbers. This guy claims to be able to go up into the megs, which it should. I don't think I have any in this assortment, and I don't really feel like digging around. I'm willing to take them at their word. If everything else is close enough, that seems reasonable to me. Let's check diode test mode. It lights it up and 2.738. That's about right for a blue LED. 2.712, the Fluke pretty much agrees, and it also lights it up. 2.84, there we go. That's pretty close. I can live with that. And, I don't know, diode voltage drop, is that something that you test on a regular basis? Maybe. I guess it's handy for dealing with unknown LEDs. Here's the random electrolytic capacitor I found littering the back of my bench. It says it's 1,000 micro. 976 micro, that's pretty close to 1,000. It's trying. Okay, there we go. 943 micro. Okay. 960 micro. That's close enough. Again, that's not a measurement that I typically use a multimeter for. Your mileage may vary. Temperature. That's something that most of my meters don't have. I usually use a separate temperature meter. I've got a video about repairing it, actually. So let's see how that works. It claims to be able to go, what did it say, minus 40 up to plus 1,000, I think. Part of that's going to be a function of this thermocouple itself. Fahrenheit, no, I don't want Fahrenheit, I want Celsius. Should be in the 20-ish range in here. Yeah, that's not bad. That went down very quick. 14, is my beer that warm? I think it's a little bit colder than that. Okay, let's try the high end. Got my iron set for 325, and it's there now. So let's see what happens. Taking a bit of time to get up there. This is still climbing. That's odd. Maybe I wasn't making good contact before. Seems to be important how you connect to this or how you are in contact with it. But obviously my soldering iron is a little bit hotter than that, otherwise it wouldn't be able to melt solder properly. But that, now I don't know if that is a function of the meter itself or a function of the thermocouple. But I don't have any, well, that's as close to a calibrated temperature as I have. That's not bad though. Gives you an idea, I guess. But unfortunately I don't have anything else calibrated at various temperatures to work with on that. On second thought, I do have something of a known temperature. Freshly harvested Canadian natural snow. From my doorstep. It should be 0 Celsius. It is 1 Celsius. That's pretty close. See what it looks like in American measurements. There we go. At least it works there. I guess it probably has to just be in really good contact with whatever it's measuring. But this guy's big trick, and the reason you might want to choose this kind of a meter over any other kind of a meter, is the clamp current measurements. So this one's got two ranges, 600 amps and 60 amps. And unlike a lot of clamp meters, this one can do both DC and AC. AC, there will be just essentially an inductive coil here and it'll pick up the magnetic field. DC, there will probably be a Hall effect sensor in there someplace dealing with that. But for DC, it's important that you zero it. Push and hold that. There we go. That zeros it. Okay. So yeah, it's important to zero it because it's going to be picking up some stuff from the surrounding area. So you just want to zero it so it's not impacting your reading when you're doing DC. So to compare this one, I actually have a couple of other clamp meters here, which are both capable of doing AC and DC. Like I said, it is fairly rare. There's lots of them that can do AC. Every electrician in the world carries one of those. But DC is a little bit less common. So here is, to compare it against, we have the Unity UT210E, which is sort of the go-to inexpensive meter that can do DC clamp. And we have a Fluke 375 that I found recently, oh, I don't know, in my work truck. It measures up to 600 amps according to its specs. This guy can measure up to 100 amps. And this guy claims to be able to do 600 amps as well. I don't think I'm going to be able to test the high end of it, but we'll do a few tests around here anyway with things that I've got. Oh, let me just set up. So to start with, we'll start at the low end. I've just got 5 volts set up on here, and I'll use my USB load to put a known current on. And then with these, you clamp them around one conductor only, not both, because then the current going that way and the current going this way will cancel each other out. So you just go around one of them. I've got this thing set right now for about a quarter of an amp, 257 on there. And the Fluke is showing 0.2 amps. Again, it's designed for higher amperage, not this low end stuff. So it's not that precise down at the bottom end. The Unity shows 253 milliamps, which is pretty close to what the power supply says. And the Kaiweets shows 0.23 amps, so 230, 240 milliamps, somewhere in that range. So again, it doesn't have the precision down at the low end, but it claims to be able to do lots of high end. So let's crank this guy up to about 2 amps. Maybe they'll be able to show their stuff a little bit better. Fluke says 2.1. Unity says 1.975. Kaiweet shows 2.04 amps, 2.01 amps. Okay, I've got a couple of 8 ohm resistors in parallel, 25 watts each. So that should be 4 ohms. And if I do the math, that should be pretty close to a little bit over 6 amps. But it's going to be more wattage than these things are expecting. So I've got my old, I've got a soldering sponge here with some water on it to hopefully keep that a little bit cool. It's got 5.8 amps here, and that says 6 amps back there. 5.71, let's push the hold button there. 5.98. So that's 5.98, that says 5.8, that says 5.7. The Kaiweets and the Unity are about the same distance off, just in the opposite directions from the Fluke. Okay, we are now entering into don't try this at home territory. This is the plug for my clothes dryer. Yes, in North America, we do have 220 volts AC. Dangerous, yeah, but I'm not completely stupid. Okay, so I've got the dryer turned back on. The black and red wire are the 220, the white is neutral, and the bare wire is the earth or ground. So 24.2 off the Fluke, that's with clamping on while it's running. That doesn't include the inrush at the beginning, which is pretty close to what the Unity came up with, almost exactly. And the Kaiweets came up with 25, so it's a little bit higher than the Fluke. And the Unity came in a bit lower than the Fluke, which we saw on the DC measurements as well. So, but still, it's within, you know, half an amp, so that's pretty damn close. Just for a bit of extra excitement, that's on AC volts range. 250.1, 250 exactly, and 250.1. So they're all pretty damn close for AC voltage as well. So to get some higher currents to check, I took the meters with me to work. This is a 24 volt power system at work. So 75.6 amps on the Fluke. 76.4 on the Kaiweets. That's pretty damn close. A problem we found, this heavy battery cable. When we're doing discharge checks, we have to check the current on it. The Kaiweets won't fit around that big cable. and it claims to be able to read 600 amps. The it just doesn't close around it, so that's not going to work. Here we are on high voltage AC, well, relatively high voltage, 107 amps or 111.7. This is 600 volt AC. 602 on the Kaiweets and 601 on the Fluke. Close enough for me. So obviously that wasn't an exhaustive test of this guy. It seems to be a decent meter, especially for the price. It's very close in price to the Unity, which, as I said, has been the sort of go-to cheap clamp meter that a lot of people have been using, including, I might add, the firearm guy that I work with on a regular basis. This is a little bit bigger. It's not a bad feel in the hand. Fairly solid detents on there. There's a few other features that I didn't explore. Like it's got a backlight on the screen. It's reasonable enough. It's got a little LED light there that you just press and hold the backlight button for a few seconds and you've got the little flashlight which is shining right at the tip of the probes. That's not bad. What about the non-contact voltage? There's a hold / non-contact voltage button over there. Okay, that works. Oh no, a nice little meter, especially for the price. I mean, it competes very well against that. Its accuracy competes well against the Fluke, which is literally 10 times the money. What it doesn't have, it doesn't have a kind of rubbery kind of case on it. This is a fairly slippery hard plastic. So here's the meter on Amazon.ca, $65, $64.99, with free shipping. Basically just describes everything that the manual says in it. Shows it being used for clamping a battery current on a car. Sure, that would be an excellent application for it. We saw this actually. When the current's over 3 amps, the display light's up. 1 inch opening, so that's the biggest wire that it can clamp around, even though there's a bit more space in there. 2.5 centimeters for the rest of us. If you prefer to buy it from Amazon.com, it's $45 American. But if you're in Canada, you probably want to buy it from the Canadian version because this shipping from the American side. Just for comparison, there's what the Unity is going for right now in Canadian dollars, so that's pretty close, actually. For a full comparison, there's what that Fluke meter would cost you, so pretty much 10 times as much as either of the other two. It claims to be certified for IEC 61010 or CAT 3 to 600 volts, double insulated, and that appears to be a 3-year warranty. That's not bad, actually, for only $65 Canadian. But yeah, as a hobbyist, or as maybe even as a pro that wants a second just cheap meter to knock around, sure. But the only thing that I'm a little bit hesitant about is, like I said, this case. And that's not reinforced with glass fiber or anything else. It's just a rigid plastic. So it's not going to take a complete beating, especially in cold weather. But that's probably not who it's targeted at anyways. Yeah, it's a cool meter, and I think I probably would definitely consider that if I was looking for a clamp meter that could do DC. Well, I hope that was somewhat informative. As I said, they sent this to me. They reached out to me. No money's changing hands. They just gave this to me to do a review, and I have done that. Well, thanks for watching. I appreciate that. As always, comments and questions down below. I'll talk to you later. Oh, I almost forgot. They said they would be giving me a discount code if you guys wanted to buy this. The discount code will be good for about a week after the video goes live and will be for Amazon.ca. I mean, international people can buy off the Canadian Amazon. That's not a big hairy deal, but that's the caveats, and I don't even know what the percentage discount is. The details will be down in the description. for as long as the discount code is active. Yeah, that's it for sure. Yeah. Thanks. Talk to you later.